My name is Emma, and I read Turing's Cathedral, and I'm here with Professor of Computer Science, Christos.
Hello.
So one of the questions that I had was, what is the Turing machine, and what did it do?
The Turing machine is, in many ways, the first computer. What is fascinating, of course, it was designed by an undergraduate, by Alan Turing. The computers were just under the horizon. A lot of people were talking about them, a lot of people were dreaming them, but Turing's particular take was special. He wanted to prove one of these theorems that tell you can't do something, okay? That something is impossible. And his theorem would say that you cannot take a logical statement and decide if it has a proof. Paradoxically, everybody else was trying to build a computer for a practical purpose. So this is the book, by the way. Okay, this is his paper. It's on computer numbers with an application to the unpronounceable.
And how old was he when he wrote this? 23.
Yeah. He had just graduated. He had just finished his undergraduate education. Among all the mathematicians who were looking to define computation, Turing got physical. He really dreamed it with states and tape. Imagine this tape, which is divided into squares, can go as long as you want either direction, and every square contains a symbol. What does symbol mean? Okay, immediately that's digital.
Can you give us an example? Can you show us a Turing machine?
Oh sure, no problem. No. That's better. Here's its tape, extends ad infinitum left and right. And this 3x3 table is its program. What's a program of a Turing machine? It is a table that tells you what to do under any possible circumstance you are going to encounter. It's interesting that Turing did not only say that the computer writes concrete, discrete symbols on it, he also said that the computer can at any moment be in one of infinitely many states of mind. So this particular machine is very simple. It can be in three states of mind, A, B, C. Let's say angry, confused, and whatever it means. Okay, right. So
and what would each state of mind imply?
So basically it says, if you are in state and you see this symbol, do this. So you see, this is a tape. It has mostly zeros. Zeros in Turing's notation were the blanks, okay? There is nothing written here, okay? When you see zero, it's like a blank. It's not very far from what your laptop does, okay? But in this tape, there is a one somewhere. And this machine wants to find it. So the mission of this machine is to find this one and stop. But it's even this task is sort of non-trivial, because you are here, you don't know to go left or right. You know, if you go left, if you go right, you will go on forever. If you go left, you'll be lucky. But who were? So, what this machine does is sort of clever. It goes right one, then left twice, then right, then left until it finds the one. Okay. So let's see why. Let's see how. We are in state A, you remember, and we are looking at the symbol zero. So let's see, you tell me, what should we do?
Right?
Yes,
2B.
And then what else? 2B. It means that we should erase this. I don't have an eraser, so I'll do this crude thing and write 2 instead.
So now we're here.
We are in state B.
With a 2.
And we see a 2. What do we do?
One to the right.
One to the right. Ah, now we are still in state B, but
we see a zero.
We see a zero. So we have to overwrite a 2 here again.
And move to state C.
Exactly.
And now we're in C and we see a 2.
Yes, it's a 2, which brings us here, which is move left. And now we see we are in C, and we still see a 2, and we move left.
Very clever. And now we're in C, and we we see a zero,
which means that we have to
mark it with a 2.
Mark with a 2. And go to B.
And go to B. And then we're in B and we see a 2.
So we go here, we go here, we go here. This C. Here, 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 victory.
Of course. So this is what a Turing machine did.
That's what the Turing machine accomplished this.
And why was that important?
No matter what a computer does, which means a human person doing computing, they're going to be writing symbols and changing states of mind and doing something like that.
So one of the things that we talked about earlier was that this was that universality was one of the most important things that Turing came up with.
Yes.
And what is universality and how does that work? And had it not existed before in other machines?
Okay. So this machine that we just saw in action is not universal. It does one particular thing, okay?
Which is?
Finding a one somewhere on the tape, okay?
Okay.
So it does this very well. Even Turing himself, later on, in England, he came up with a machine whose only purpose was to break the German code.
Successfully.
Yeah. All these people who were thinking about computers, They were thinking about computers to do one specific thing.
So if there wasn't universality, we would have a different computer for adding numbers.
Exactly. You would go to a computer store and it would be many departments, okay? There would be the department of scientific calculations,
mm-hmm.
of business calculations, of sending emails, of browsing the web, of doing your taxes, okay?
And they would all be separate computers.
Right, right, yeah. Okay. So, you know, this was the how people were seeing the future. So Turing came up with this idea. He, you know, I showed you a very simple machine that does something else. Turing came up with another machine, which is a universal machine. What does universal mean? It means the following. That machine can take a description of another machine and then mimic that other machine.
And how would it get the description?
Look into the inner, you know, the codes of other machines. And if you think about it, that's the beginning of software. The reason you don't have a computer that does many different things, each one of the different tasks, is because we just download from the web a piece of software and does it for us. Software is the most important component of the computer. I mean, that's actually what, you know, software says the following, that what you have here, what you have on your tape, on your memory, on the computer's memory, the symbols that you have in your computer's memory, can be both nouns and verbs, okay? Can be both data and code.
And so how does that work?
People write programs that do all these things that need to be done on a machine. And then there is a kind of universal Turing machine today that is called a compiler or interpreter,
mm-hmm.
that takes these programs and makes them into simple symbols that go into the computer's memory. And then these symbols make the computer do nice or nasty things on other symbols. Okay, these are the, so to speak, the verbs.
On other digits.
Other digits, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. Von Neumann was obviously very much influenced by Turing's ideas, especially about the universality. That's why his machine, the von Neumann machine, is almost pointedly universal. Through the software, use the symbols to write code, which tells symbols what to do to other symbols. Okay, so you know it's this duality in computers. Okay, that you have both programs and data and the same thing. In some sense, computers are the only device that's universal. Okay, when somebody, an obscure physicist somewhere in Switzerland in 1999, discovered how to click, what now we do.
Like or click
a mouse and go somewhere else in the world. And all these computers, thanks to Turing, they were universal.
So they could be taught how to click.
They could be taught in an instant how to click. So, and the reason why the internet and the web spread like wildfire is exactly this, that the computers were universal.
Because of Turing.
Because of Turing.
And what happened to Turing? What did he go on to do for the rest of his life? Because he was so young when he invented.
Well, he came to the United States and got his PhD from Princeton. Then the war broke out. He went back to England and he was one of the scientific leaders of the effort to break the German codes.
Which he successfully
did. Then he went on to help kickstart the British computer industry after the war. And then, as the book says in one of its last pages, he had an incredible death. He was essentially murdered by the state he helped win the war.
And how did they kill him?
So Turing was homosexual. That was illegal in the UK in 1952. Turing was an amazing man. You know, he was, as a scientist, he lived 30-40 years ahead of his time. Unfortunately, he got carried away and lived his personal life as if it was 30-40 years ahead of his time. So he volunteered to a police officer that he's homosexual.
He told the police officer?
Yeah. You know, he was asking about something else, and he said that, and do you know this man? I said, yes. Do you know him well? Yes. How well? Well, he's my lover. He was given a choice, either go to jail or take hormones.
And they were believed to be a cure for being queer.
Yes, it was believed to be a cure, yes.
And it did something to his mind.
He committed suicide.
How old was he when he died?
42.
42.
I mean, well, he would be a very old man now, but it's not completely unthinkable that he'll be alive. We just had 100 years from his birth.
Hearing the story about Turing, for me it's interesting because it shows how the history of computer science was actually, the discipline was actually built by Jewish exiles, by queer men, by women, and that is a very different story than I would have expected, the way that computer science is often talked about in many big disciplines. Like, you don't know who built it until you read about
the
story.
That's right, that's right. So interestingly, I mean, that's a wonderful observation. I mean, women were very active in the beginnings of computers. What von Neumann succeeded is to build a computer like today's computers and software. Actually, his wife, Clara, she was in some sense the first programmer. You know, there are some beautiful pictures showing Clara programming and von Neumann kibbutzing over her shoulder. And then some strange thing happened. I mean, you know, if I look at my class, only 20% of the students are female. And the reason is, I believe, that during the 80s and 90s and zeros, what happened is that the hacker culture prevailed. I really think that the computer scientists today must understand humans, must understand many other sciences, must understand social science, must understand the psychology, feelings, okay, must understand the history.
Thank you for talking to me. I loved learning about Turing machines, and if I was an undergraduate, I probably would take a computer science class.
Great.
I was always afraid to when I was actually an undergrad. I regret that.
So. You can do it now, you know.
I know, it's true. Thank you.
Thank you.